Welcome back. Star Wars Battlefront 2 is the highlight of EA's press conference, where a ton of gameplay and mechanics were revealed. Max Scoville is joining me for a look at the game with Craig and Paul. Star Wars.
Yeah. We've
been screaming it for 24 hours. Max and I have been screaming it for 30 plus years.
Same.
Same. Good. So we're in good hands. Okay, here's this interview can go two ways. One, we can go deep dive. We can get into the real intricacies. Two, we can just start blurting out Star Wars animals' names and asking you if they're in there. Let's try to do a mix of both.
Sure.
Starting with Rancors.
That's how you're starting it?
I'm just going to say Rancors.
Starting?
I'm sorry. I told you we'd softball it, but he really needs to know. The man loves his Rancors.
I really like Rancors. Oh, will we see maybe even a Rancor skeleton somewhere?
Oh, is that giving away too much?
I don't know.
Didn't say no. They did not say no.
We didn't instantly.
Got a Rancor's question mark.
Okay, so let's get into this a little bit more like kind of top level. Obviously, a lot of people kind of came away from Battlefront when it first launched feeling it was light on content, and you guys have said this is, what, three times the content?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And the DLC is going to be free.
Yep.
What? Please elaborate.
Okay, so there are, we heard a lot from our fans, right? We got so much feedback. We had our first game, we had a year of live service. And what we really wanted to do is we wanted to address three core concerns. One was, where's that story? You know, we really want a story, and not only just a story, but we want an untold story. And we decided to pick something really special from the other side, so something from the Imperial side. So that's really special. Next thing that people really want is they said, where's space? Give me space, right?
It's up there.
We know it's up there. How do I get there? So what we did is, you know, we touched on it in the Death Star expansion pack, but now we're going to bring in launch. And we got Criterion on board, same as we have Motive working with the single player. And these people are experts at what they do, and they're really just adding so much to the game. And then it was about the multiplayer. It's like the multiplayer is good, but where's that breadth and where's that depth?
Yep. Right.
Right. Yep. So how do we access all of these eras? How do we access more of our heroes, more of the locations that we love? And how do I get the depth so that I don't achieve my goals so quickly that, you know, I'm not sure where to go? So all of these points are points we're addressing.
Yeah. So one of my problems with the first game was the fact that unlocking stuff felt kind of grindy, you know, like to get like a cool hat, it would take hours and hours, and it's like I could just go to the store and get a hat. You guys have like kind of a new currency resource system. Could you talk a little bit about that? Like you get points in the game as you're playing
the battle point system,
right?
Right. So that's more for if you want to become a hero or a special character on the field.
Okay.
That's where we're adding some of the depth and giving you a chance to live out a bit more of your Star Wars fantasies in terms of more unique things that we had in the first game. And we want to make it easier for players to, you know, how does my direct gameplay allow me to do that thing very easily? Before it was a token system, a little bit unfair. If you knew where it was, you could find your way there.
Right.
Now it's like, if I'm just doing some team play, if I'm just working around with the others, I'm going to gain enough points, and then I can spend that on becoming a hero. Or if you get to play our Assault on, or our Theed gameplay, you get to become a B2 battle droid. There's so much stuff that you can do just by playing with your team, playing the objective, which is what we really want people to do in this game.
Yeah,
okay. So plenty of opportunities for people.
You're using some Battlefield language there. Playing the objective and all that. That's kind of the thing there. One of the things I've gotten really into Battlefield 1 since then, and that's kind of a game where there's so much chaos. You've got horses and tanks and trucks out there. And it's cool to see, I think in the first Battlefront, you'd have infantry, and then there were heroes, and there were vehicles, and they were very kind of separate. And now you've got super battle droids, and you've got AT-RTs walking around.
Mm-hmm.
Is it sort of more of a gradual scaling thing in terms of the stuff that's fighting?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we're trying to create that tiered experience. So the great thing about the battle point system is it's so flexible, right? I can, whatever positive action I do, whether it is playing the objective, killing people, supporting my team, I can save all my points and try and get to that hero, but I now have player choice. I can now turn around and say, you know what? I'm super great as a clone jump trooper, or I'm an incredible pilot. So what I will do is maybe I'll spend less points, you know, a smaller amount of points, get to be that pilot, rack them up faster, and get to where I want to be.
Right. Okay.
So it's all about having multiple ways to get to wherever you want to be in our
game. You've got sort of branching paths of your career progression in a way. That's really awesome. So I adored the maps in the last game, especially the ones based on Endor. Like I got goosebumps the first time I did a like 40-player Walker assault mission on Endor. I had never seen a Star Wars game like that. Are we going to see some of those like classic maps return? Are we going to go to Endor and have like a sort of remixed version? Like how is what we've seen going to sort of impact what's still to come?
Yeah. So I think With our signature mode that we're actually showing off here on Theed, it's Galactic Assault. And what this will do is this will go from planet to planet. And the important thing here is that it invokes the fantasy and the spirit of that planet. So when you think about back to the first Battlefront, you know, stepping on Hoth, what was magical about that? It was stepping into that fantasy that you'd always want to live as a fan. Now here with Theed, we're stepping into that invasion fantasy where you see that droid army take on this, you know, this crown jewel of Naboo. So every time you go to a planet, whatever planet it is, and there are multiple planets across all three eras now, you will invoke that that fantasy, and you will feel that immersion that that Hoth brought that was so
Now, my Theed fantasies usually involve Gungans, and I'm not seeing any here. So what are the chances we're going to get to see some of those floppy-eared boys running around? I mean, who knows?
Yeah,
who
exactly.
knows?
I mean, I
he didn't say that.
I personally would love to add a Jar Jar or something. Yeah. Who knows? Like, you know, but you know, we'll see what we bring. I mean, that's you mentioned free DLC earlier.
Right.
There's plenty of places that we can go and take that as time rolls on.
Such as Otagunga, maybe?
Mm-hmm.
That would be super bomb bad, guys.
I really enjoyed in the last game this sort of diorama mode of just unlocking figurines and rotating them. Max and I, our desk at IGN is covered in Star Wars toys. And there was a collectible aspect to that I think that Star Wars fans understand, right? Mm-hmm. The new movies come out, our wallets open up, and everything flies out.
Of course.
Do you guys have anything along those lines planned for this game, like sort of collectibles, sort of like unlockables along those lines?
Yeah, no, absolutely. There's a whole host of collectibles and unlockables. There's far more than there has ever been. When we think, you know, we think about there's vanity items. There's going to be a whole host of new star cards, and not only star cards, but like rarities of star cards. I think that's a really important thing to mention is before when you got your star card, that was it.
Yeah.
Now you can upgrade that star card across different rarities, and it will either become more powerful or last a longer duration, so that you can, you know, it's really just the beginning getting that card.
Okay. So I'm hearing you've got paid stuff in some form in there. Is that correct? And it's for like loot boxes. I think I read that.
Yep.
I actually am like. I love that because it doesn't screw up the game, you know, it's not segmenting the community.
Exactly.
But at the same time, I'm probably going to spend money on it to try to get some weird costume or something. And that's kind of a problem. Is it going to be how weird are you going to get with cosmetic stuff? That's going to be a you problem too. Just wait and see.
It's definitely a me problem.
You know, like we've seen people going crazy for like, you know, weird special Overwatch skins and going, is it kind of going that direction, would you say?
I don't think it'll be that over the top. You know, we're a very authentic experience.
Right.
We want to give you skins that you would expect to say, I've seen a character wear that before, or that doesn't seem out of character for that character, if I could use that word twice.
Okay. So maybe not like a droids animated series Boba Fett.
Yeah, that'd be a little bit weird.
Oh, like in terms of a aesthetic look versus authentic like Boba Fett?
Horrible.
Yeah, no, nothing like that.
I just think that would be hilarious to just have like this purple
yeah.
Boba Fett
like
show
a cel-shaded
that'd
Boba Fett.
Be really jarring. But at the same time, like maybe having like a battle droid skin where it's got like 3PO's head or something. Like that happens in the movies.
I saw some people asking about that.
Okay. Yeah.
I mean, those are things that we can always explore, but like I think right now we're going to the authentic experience that people know from the movies as a base. And then we can always see what goes on after
that.
Yeah,
for sure.
Are you guys willing to talk at all in terms of just sheer numbers of maps, planets, vehicles, and stuff in the game at launch, or is that still kind of off limits?
I mean, really not going to numbers at this point.
Okay.
You know, but we can say, like, say this is huge. You know, you heard people say that it's three times larger, and it's a massive game.
Yeah.
If you saw our EA Play stream, then you will see that like this is the most ambitious game that we've ever tried to make with EA, and I can say from personal experience, it definitely feels that way. I've been working in this industry a long time, and this is by far the most ambitious thing we've ever
attempted. It seems like the ships are integrated into multiplayer a lot more sort of strategically, and it seems like someone like me who would hop in a TIE fighter and then just immediately die might have a better chance now. How does that sort of that ground to sky combat work?
I think that's the brilliance that Criterion helps to bring to this game. Is they are masters at vehicles and vehicle handling. So what we did with the first game is we created this very, you know, an accessible experience, but perhaps it was a bit too disjointed from the ground combat. So they've been working really hard to not only add more depth with things like manual roll and leading the like leading reticules and everything, but you can see that it's much easier. You get a soft lock when you're strafing down, so that you can actually really connect the aerial layer with the ground layer for like a more holistic experience.
Yeah. Now, does the vulture droid transform into the fun spider walker that you see in episode 1, or is that like mixing things up too much?
That would be mixing things
up. Yeah, I just imagine that sounds like a headache, and it wouldn't be fair to those fine people in the Naboo fighters.
For the last game, you guys went into the vaults of Lucasfilm, and you scanned a bunch of high-res statues that were props and artifacts of the original trilogy. But the prequel trilogy is mostly CG, pre-rendered. There's some props there. Obviously, there's a lot of tangible goods that were made. What was it like to create versions of the prequel trilogy that were basically CG to begin with, and then make them, you know, look the way they do in modern video game graphics? Yeah.
I think it was a little bit easier because a lot of it was digital, so they can pass those assets over to us. We can work with them and kind of make it match our art style.
Yeah.
You know, our art style is authentic, so it's very realistic looking, similar to what you would have seen in the movies. So it's a little bit easier than having to physically scan everything and then kind of do a little bit of work on top of that. We still would have to touch them up a bit because, you know, it needs to fit our game, but a little bit easier just because they're digital assets to play around with.
I think it's really cool because it's kind of just, it's helping smooth that kind of disparity between the prequel and original trilogy. And there are people who love both, there are people who love all of them, there are people who love one and hate the other.
Yep.
And it's just really cool that it helps meld them. And it's fascinating to see a super battle droid that looks more realistic in a video game than it does in the movie. I'm dying to see what Kamino looks like because you're taking like Frostbite's rain effects and I mean, it's considerably more advanced than what ILM was using, you know, 15 years ago.
Yeah.
Are you focusing more on prequel content, or is it going to be a mix of everything and you're just kind of leading with the prequels to get those people on board?
I mean, it's a mix of everything. Like, we are going to bring absolutely a mix of everything. The reason why we brought here is people have been shouting for the prequels for a long time. People have been shouting for Darth Maul and seeing that incredible acrobatic, you know, Sith Lord moving through the map and just wreaking havoc. It's also showing much more of an urban environment that is an environmental. So it showed off so many highlights that we had, and I think it's just an incredible credit to you know, our art team and our art directors that what they managed to do is something similar to what Rogue One as a movie did. Was you know, it's when you watched it, it didn't look like they did like the original trilogy movies, but it looked how you remembered that they would look like.
It felt like sort of tonally familiar.
Exactly. Yeah. So that's what we're doing, and that's how we're trying to bring the prequels and the original and the new all in line with each other for this holistic.
And that's the thing about sort of, you know, Darth Maul specifically had the entire IGN War Room cheering, clapping, because he's just incredibly fun to watch.
Yeah.
But when you see him in the movie, he's not really there much. He only does a couple of cool moves. You guys had to kind of fill in the blanks. What's it like to sort of say, you know, how would Darth Maul run upstairs?
I mean, that's a fun challenge for the character team back home. But a lot of it is just what makes that character, you know, you remember the character a certain way. You kind of have this vision of how he would be. We work with Lucasfilm to kind of cultivate that and say, how does that translate into gameplay?
Right.
So a lot of that is making it feel like that's what the character would do. It's believable that he would go do this thing. You know, he's a very agile fighter in the movies. You see him when he's fighting Qui-Gon and Obi-Wan. Okay, how do we translate that to gameplay? Okay, he's bouncing around, he's doing these things. He's just, and it's again, being authentic to the character and just teasing that out and bringing it to life in gameplay.
Okay. Now, we talked a lot about the kind of the class system and the different differences between sort of ground level gameplay. Does that apply to Heroes too? Are there sort of different ways to play Heroes? Is there any customization there?
Absolutely. I mean, we want to make sure that, first of all, the heroes embody that character, right? So they have different styles. You've got Darth Maul, who's incredibly acrobatic, great at close quarters. You have Boba Fett, who is far more mobile and can rain death and destruction from the air, which is fantastic. You've got Rey, who's adept at mind tricks. Like, these, we really want to embody those characters, but each of these characters, similar to the troopers and also similar to our starfighters in space battles, are going to have so much customization. They're going to have multiple cards that you can collect for them, multiple rarities, so that basically my hero will not play the same as your hero. I can make sure that my playstyle is embodied within my character.
That's really cool to hear.
So one of the things I really loved about the last Battlefront game was that I'm not great at shooters, which is probably why it took Max and I so long to unlock stuff. It was kind of an arcadey, kind of casual shooter. But you guys, it seems like you're swinging for a kind of a more hardcore game here. How are you doing that?
I wouldn't say it's more hardcore. We're just trying to add more depth to the gunplay. And, you know, with the introduction of classes, we give a bit more of that ability for you to have more distinct roles on the battlefield. How do you work together? So it's adding just depth on top of what is already there. We don't necessarily need to reinvent the wheel and make it too hardcore.
Cool.
We don't want to be quite as far as maybe like a battlefield is in terms of the realism of the gun, but we still want some weight to the gun, make it feel a bit different, and just add some mechanics that players are wanting to use so they can have a bit of a, okay, I feel good with this gun. I feel good with that gun. How do I continue my path down that? How do I evolve that gun? How do I unlock things for the gun, change up how it feels? So it doesn't, not a hardcore shooter, but it's not a casual one either. We're trying to find something that is a good mix for everybody.
Okay. Now you have Yoda in the game, which immediately evokes to me Odd Job in GoldenEye. Like, you got this troll little thing that's going to run around and just shoot everyone in the knees, and no one can hit him because they're shooting over his head. How do you account for that?
I mean, that's a challenge. Like, we're still tweaking things with him. We're still trying to figure out how do you fine tune that.
Yep.
But you know, he's an iconic character. You can't not have Yoda.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But then we'll play with gameplay stuff. Like, you know, maybe he has some abilities that play into that fact, or maybe there's some ways that we work around that with other abilities or what the troopers can do. But it's, I don't think it'll be quite Odd Job, but it'll be, you know, he is shorter. So, yeah.
Now, we've seen Luke in his Return of the Jedi outfits, and we've seen Rey in her Force Awakens outfit, and we've also seen her in her Last Jedi costume, which I think is pre-order bonus, right?
Yep.
Are we going to see a Luke in Last Jedi outfit, Force Awakens? Is that a costume we might see show up, maybe?
They did not say no.
Yeah, that's one of those developer
he's
shrugs.
Inside the ring.
Yeah.
Tauntauns. Are in your game.
Yes, they are.
Yeah. Can I ride a Tauntaun through
you
battle?
You can, absolutely.
I almost cursed. That's awesome. That's so awesome. There was a Tauntaun skeleton in the last game. I'm telling you guys, we played a lot of Battlefront. how do you make that work? How do you go like, okay, well, all of a sudden, like, we have these space kangaroos, and like, do you hear them running through? Like, they're like, la 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 la.
Is it like a vehicle that you can shoot and kill? Like, is it like a horse in Battlefield?
Yeah, I'd say it's fairly similar to something like that.
Okay.
Yeah. But I mean, I don't want it. You shouldn't shoot and kill Tauntauns, man.
Unless you're cold.
That's true. Unless you need to cuddle up for some warmth.
Can you climb inside it and regain your health?
No, that's something we missed.
We got a hard no on that.
It is a bit gory. I don't know if we want to allow
I'm not
for
sure
that.
If our rating
it's canon.
That.
It's totally canon.
Now I gotta flex just a very nerdy muscle here. In the trailer, there's that one shot of Yavin. You got Death Troopers on there, and there's this blurry thing that runs by in the foreground, and you sort of see its butt.
Yeah.
Is that a run-yip?
It's a run-yip.
Wow! Yes! I did it! Nailed it!
Well
Sorry.
Done.
Nailed I, it. I tweeted at Pablo Hidalgo, and I was like, can you confirm or deny what this hippopotamus duck tiger thing is? And I think he's blocked
Max me. Grabbed me before. He's like, oh, I think this is a run-yip. He's like showing me these drawings on DeviantArt of run-yip. I'm like,
sure, man, sure. That was for something else.
So, that must be a ton of fun to just go into the depths of weird Star Wars lore and pull out stuff like that. I mean, even in the single player campaign, we see that Palpatine Sentinel.
Yep.
So I screamed at the entire room. I was like, is that a Palpatine robot? And everyone was like, actually,
it has a name.
You have to read Shattered Empire in the Aftermath book by Chuck Wendig.
the wildlife and I mean, all of this is part of our living world, right? So a lot of people ask us to say like, why don't you have full scale destruction? Why is that not there? You know, I've seen that in Battlefield. Why is that not in Star Wars? And it's like, that's not part of the Star Wars universe, right? You know, when I fire blasters at things, you get scorch marks. You don't actually destroy a whole bunch of things. So what we want to bring, what we want as our signature element, is this living world.
Right.
So when you start, let's go back to Theed for a second. When you start with this intro run-up, if you're starting from the droid army, then you're seeing these MTTs unload these battalions of droids. You're seeing drop ships come in. If you're on the clone side, you'll see LAATs dropping off a whole bunch of clones, setting up defenses and things like this. You'll see civilians running away. On things like Yavin, you'll see run-yips. You'll see, you know, a whole bunch of wildlife, because we want the world to still feel alive and still feel dynamic without necessarily invoking things like destruction.
I mean, a lot of the team...
Gungans are civilians.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of the team...
They're like, too, right?
They are second-class civilians in the city of Theed, good sir.
But I was saying, a lot of the team back home, they're huge Star Wars fans too. Another one's going like, hey, on this planet, we really need these things.
Yeah.
Let's make sure we have run-yips in there. Let's make sure we have this thing here. They're deep in that lore, and they're the ones that are really fueling a lot of this great stuff that you guys are seeing.
I probably spent like 5 hours walking around the Jabba's Palace map on the outside just looking for that weird, like, toilet frog that comes out. It's like, where is he? And everyone's like shooting me, and I'm not helping anyone.
Yeah, that was kind of a recurring theme in our games, was us stopping to just like stare at the scenery and then get shot in the head by someone who's better at the game and has a cool costume.
So you're making a map based on Crait, which is a section of a new planet that we saw for just a few seconds in the Last Jedi trailer. We saw those new ships sort of just like skirmishing over it, dust kicking up. Like, dust kicks up every time something happens on that planet, apparently. How does that work?
That will be a fun one to figure out.
Yeah.
I think it'll be really interesting to see how we can make that happen. And I think that, you know, there's stuff that we can do. That Frostbite engine is super powerful.
Yeah.
We'll figure out an interesting way to make that happen. And so you could relive that moment, right?
Now, here's a question for you. Obviously, Battlefront 1 was aligned perfectly with The Force Awakens, which was probably the most hyped I've seen anybody for Star Wars almost ever. We've got The Last Jedi. This new trilogy is more of a known quantity. Are you guys going to have more Last Jedi stuff in there at launch, or is it going to be crate and then just kind of like save the rest for DLC so you're not...
So when we start moving into our live service, I mean, that first season is going to be centered around The Last Jedi. And yes, we'll be visiting that new planet of Krayt. We'll have Finn and we'll have Phasma. I'm sure you saw John Boyega. Mm-hmm. He's super excited mm-hmm. to be seeing himself and playing himself in the game. And then there's a lot more that we can do. We can, you know, there's a lot more opportunities that we could do with new movies. But when you come to this idea of seasons and when you make it available to everybody, then, you know, you start opening this universe to an entire community, keeping that entire community together. I don't have to worry about whether, you know, Paul or yourself has bought something. Can I still play with you? So there's so many opportunities to expand this universe, but as a whole as well.
That's awesome to hear. Yeah. Are you going to be taking any input from the community in terms of what kind of content you create, or is it all laid out in advance?
I think the beauty that we have with these seasons is that we can actually start reacting to the community a lot faster, you know. I would say with our first season of live service for Battlefront 1, like, we had it pretty well laid out for the start. We knew what beats we wanted to hit and where we wanted to go. I think this one is much more organic. Like, of course, we have ideas as to what we want to do, but, you know, if something amazing happens in the community or in the world of Star Wars or just, you know, things that people want,
yep.
we can now react in a super fast way. So it's really beneficial for us as developers and also as our, you know, for our players.
On sort of personal levels, you've obviously played this game a ton so far. Who are your favorite heroes and villains to play as and why so far?
I'd say of the ones that we've shown, it's easily Darth Maul. There's nothing like I can describe running into the palace itself with Darth Maul, spinning around, taking out tons of clone troops. It's ridiculous. And watching others do it, we've had some of our game changers playing around with the build, and just crazy nonsense. It's over the top. You just need to do it yourself.
Yeah, he's like a human fidget spinner. He's just sort of like rolling down the hallways, like jutting through the sky. There's lights and lasers everywhere.
Yeah.
But you've got Rey also, and she looks awesome to play.
We got Rey. Yes. Rey's a fantastic character, and Rey, as one of her abilities, is Mind Trick. And I can see a lot of people trolling. So what this happens is when you use the Mind Trick, then it'll start to invert some of the controls on your opposing players.
Yeah.
So it's like if you're super clever, you can get there quickly, but chances are what you're going to do is you're going to start fooling people, and you're going to start taking that advantage. So I see big trolling here.
Of course. And I think the great thing about the way that we've designed a lot of the hero characters is you're able to work well with a team. So if you can imagine Rey mind-tricking everybody, they're all confused, somebody else comes flying in, maybe it's Han from the side, comes and start taking out people.
Yeah.
It's how do the heroes work together?
Not just
a hero individually, because
yeah.
you know, we'll have more heroes playable on the map in this game versus the first game.
So Rey can use her Jedi mind tricks to invert your controls.
Yes.
Yeah.
Is that a Last Jedi spoiler?
I don't think they have controls.
I don't. Do they have pads?
They don't have controls in The Last Jedi.
They don't have controls. So you're going to do Kylo. We know Kylo Ren's there, right?
Yep.
And we haven't seen Finn. We haven't seen Phasma. My guess was because we haven't seen those characters in the new film yet. One of them got slashed in the back. We saw him in like this new back-to-tank suit. And the other was because Captain Phasma, I think, just got dumped in the garbage can.
Yeah.
So are we... Are we going to get to see those characters based on their new designs, their old designs?
Ooh.
Oh, that's a good one. We'll see. No, that's good. We'll see.
All right.
Yeah.
All right. Cool.
I keep trying, man.
I appreciate it.
One more question. Maybe not. I don't know how much time we have. We could keep doing this for a while. So obviously you've got a campaign for the first time.
Yeah.
Not the first time, but, you know, and there are new planets invented that. We've got Eden Versio's home planet with all the you know, red orchid trees and stuff.
Yep.
Is that going to be a multiplayer map or is that strictly single player?
So that environment is strictly for a single player.
Okay.
It's part of Iden's story and her journey, because her journey takes place between the end of The Return of the Jedi and then, of course, the beginning of Force Awakens. And it meets, it's not only just her journey, but she also encounters iconic characters such as Luke and new planets and stuff. So there's a whole bunch of stuff that we're keeping for that single player experience, but then there is nothing stopping us from converting, you mm-hmm. know, if we find that these are loved environments and,
yep.
and loved places, then we can start to create multiplayer maps out of them.
Awesome. Thank you guys so much for coming by. As you can see, we're incredibly giddy for Star Wars. We will not shut up about it.